Recorded Books and One Click Digital present MacCallister, 10 Guns from Texas, by William W. Johnstone with J.A. Johnstone. Narrated by me, George Waddell. Chapter 1. Chugwater, Wyoming. Duff MacCallister was having a scotch with Baldy Johnson at the Fiddler's Green Saloon when Wang Chow came in.
"Hey!" someone shouted. "What's that Chinaman doing in my drinking bar?"
"This isn't your drinking bar, it is mine," Baldy said. "You may have noticed on the sign out front, just under the name Fiddler's Green, it says Baldy Johnson Proprietor."
"Yeah, well, it seems to me like you would have more consideration for your customers than to allow a stinking Chinaman to come into a bar where white men are drinking. I think you should throw him out."
"Throw him out yourself," Baldy replied, smiling across the table at Duff.
"Really? You mean it's all right with you if I throw him out?"
"Sure, go ahead." Wang Chow looked at Duff, who, with a smile, nodded at him.
"Hood, you really planning on throwing that Celestial out of here?" one of the other saloon customers asked.
"Yeah." With a malevolent smile, Hood left the bar and started toward Wang Chow.
"What's your name, Chinaman?"
"My name is Wang Chow."
"Well, Wang Chow, you got two choices. You can either turn around and leave now, or you can let me mop up this floor with you and throw you out. Which will it be?"
"I do not wish to do either," Wang Chow replied.
"Well, then we'll do it my way."
Hood swung, putting everything into a wide right cross. Wang Chow ducked easily under the wild swing, then shot out his hand, palm forward, striking Hood in the chest. The return blow surprised Hood and drove him back several steps.
"Why, you—"
Hood swung again, missing as badly as he did the first time. Wang Chow hit Hood on his forehead with the heel of his hand.
"Stop playing around with him, Hood," someone said.
Hood decided to try a straight jab and shot his left fist forward. Wang Chow moved his head to one side easily, and with no show of effort, hit Hood in the side, just under his arm. Hood punched and swung again and again, never once making contact with Wang Chow, who, with movements as graceful as those of a dancer, responded to every one of Hood's attempts with a counterpunch that scored. It soon became very evident that Wang Chow was carrying Hood and could at any time have dealt him a fight-ending blow. Hood was getting more and more frustrated and more exhausted. Finally, breathing heavily, he stopped and held up his hand.
"What did you say your name was?"
"I am Wang Chow."
"Well, Wang Chow, come over here and let me buy your drink. I need to make friends with anybody who can fight the way you do."
"Why don't the two of you come over to my table?" Baldy called out to them. "I'll get the drinks. You've probably worn yourself out."
"You've got that right," Hood said.
The two men walked over to sit at the table with Duff and Baldy.
"Where did you learn to fight like that?" Hood asked.
"I am a priest of the Shaolin Temple of Changlin," Wang Chao replied.
"A priest? I'll be damned if I've ever seen a padre who could do that." "Wang Chao isn't the kind of priest you are thinking of," Duff said. "A Shaolin priest is a most unique individual. Wang Chao entered the temple as a boy of 9 and left when he was 28 years old, a master of the Chinese martial art of Wushu."
"How did you wind up in America?" Hood asked.
"Some evil men killed my mother and my sister," Wang Chao said. "When I went to the temple to burn incense to honor my family, the master of the temple told me to seek no revenge. I was told that if I did so, it would bring dishonor to the temple."
"Damn, but you done it anyway, didn't you?" Hood asked.
"Yes. I cut the top knot to my hair, which distanced me from the temple. Then I went to the tongue of the men who had done the evil thing. 6 men were there laughing about having killed my family."
Wang Chao stopped.
"Well, go on," Hood said. "What happened?"
"I killed them."
"Wait a minute. You said there were 6 of them."
"Yes."
"And you killed all 6?
"I am ashamed to say that I let my temper control me."
"So you shot all 6 of them?"
"I do not use guns," Wang said.
"Then how'd you kill them?"
"I killed them with the sword."
"What happened then?"
"I was expelled from the Changlin Temple, and the Empress Dowager Cian issued a decree ordering my death. I left China with a group of laborers and came to America to work on the railroad," Wang said in conclusion.
"Damn," Hood said. I'm glad I didn't really make you mad.
Duff and Baldy laughed.
Say, Duff, is it true you're going to be taking some of your beeves to Texas?
Baldy asked.
Aye, it is true. I've been dealing with a man named Jason Bellefontaine. He owns the Slash Bell Ranch at Merrilltown, which is near Austin. He wants some angus to improve his herd.
How soon will you be gone?
I expect it'll be at least another month before we've got everything worked out. I've checked with the railroad. 'Tis 500 of the creatures I'll be taking, so 'tis 20 cars I'll be needing.
You're taking cows to Texas?
Hood laughed.
Here, now, and if that ain't about the funniest thing I've ever heard, I thought cows come out of Texas, not go in.
These are Angus cattle. 'Tis a special breed from Scotland, they are, and far superior to the Longhorns, and aye, even the Hereford.
Superior how?
Hood asked.
Oh, in about every way you can count,
Elmer Gleason said, joining the conversation.
They have lower calf weights, so the birthing is a lot easier, which means you don't lose as many during calving season. They produce a quality carcass, and that means a better beef. But now you take a Hereford, they have a higher birth weight, and they got white faces which could cause the pink eye. Also, they ain't as calm as the Angus is, neither.
What about the Longhorn?
Hood asked.
Anyone who is still raising Longhorns don't even deserve to be called a cattleman,
Elmer said.
What do you know about being a cattleman?
Hood teased.
I mean, seeing you ain't nothing but a cowboy your own self.
Oh, on the contrary, Mr. Hood, Duff said. Mr. Gleason owns a substantial piece of Sky Meadow. He's every bit a cattleman and has a personal stake in the safe delivery of these cows to Mr. Bellefontaine.
Near Phantom Hill, Texas. As Duff and the others were having a pleasant gathering in Fiddler's Green, some 850 miles south, two outlaws, Al Simmons and Hugh Decker, were on the run. They're coming, I can feel it in my gut. They are out there and they're close. Simmons climbed down from a rock and walked over to his horse, where he slipped his rifle out of the saddle holster.
What is it you're planning on doing with that rifle?
Decker asked. When they get here, I'm going to commence shooting. It looks to me like we don't have no other choice.
Yeah, Decker agreed. Yeah, you're probably right.
With rifles in hand, the two men climbed back up onto the rock that afforded them not only a good view of the approaching trail, but also some cover and concealment. They checked the loads in their rifles, eased the hammers back to half-cock, then hunkered down on the rock and waited.
Let 'em come up to about 50, maybe 75 yards away, Simmons suggested.
He and Decker weren't career outlaws. Until earlier that day, they had never done anything against the law. But they'd held up the Abilene stagecoach. During the robbery, they took nothing from the passengers, stealing only the money being transported by the coach. They believed they had every right to do that because, until the week before, they had worked for the stage company, keeping the coaches in good repair. However, their supervisor had come in drunk and offensive. They'd gotten into a row with him, and he fired them. When they took their case to the station manager, he upheld his supervisor. To make things worse, they were each due 2 weeks' pay, and the company withheld their pay, claiming it was a fine. They had moped over the unjust treatment for a few days. When they learned that the bank was expecting a shipment of money, they made up their minds to rob the coach. Even though they had worn masks during the holdup, the driver had recognized them, and a posse hastily formed had chased them into a dead-end canyon. As the thieves waited, the posse came into view over a distant rise.
There they are, Decker said.
I see them.
Simmons raised his rifle to his shoulder.
Wait a minute, Decker cautioned. Don't shoot.
He reached up to pull Simmons' rifle down.
They don't have no idea we're here.
You're right. I'll wait until they get closer, Simmons agreed.
They waited as the distant riders came closer, sometimes seeming not to be riding, but rather floating as they materialized and dematerialized in the heat waves rising from the ground. On they rode across the long, flat plain.
It's taken them forever to get here, Simmons complained.
Yeah, well, what else have we got to do?
Decker asked with a chuckle.
Nothing, I suppose, Simmons replied, also chuckling.
The two men waited until the posse closed to less than 100 yards. Simmons lifted his rifle again and rested it carefully against the rock, taking a very careful aim.
Wait until they get just a little closer, he said quietly. I'll give you the word.
and we'll both fire at the same time.
No, Decker said.
Simmons looked at him in confusion.
What do you mean, no?
Think about it, Al. Do we really want to do this?
What do you mean, do we want to do this? Seems to me like we don't have no choice. In case you ain't noticed, this here is a dead-end canyon. We ain't got no way out except through them.
There's at least 20 of them.
There's two of us, Decker said. What difference does it make how many we shoot? We'll still be dead in the end.
Simmons nodded. That's probably true.
And consider this. Some of them men is our friends, Decker said. Hell, me and you had Thanksgiving dinner with Phil Burke and his wife. And how many times have we pitched horseshoes with Danny Mitchell? If we start shooting now, we'll wind up killing some of our friends. I don't mind going to meet my maker as a thief, but damn if I want to meet him with murder on my conscience.
What do you propose that we do?
I say we give up. We'll be going to prison. Yeah, well, at least we'll be alive. And we won't be murderers. Besides, they'll feed us there, and we'll have a place to sleep. It ain't like we don't know no one that's there. How bad can it be?
Yeah, Simmons said. Yeah, you're right.
So what do we do now?
We give up.
I'll call down to him.
Decker cupped his hands around his mouth.
Phil! He shouted. Phil Burke! Burke, Burke, Burke! Echoed back from the canyon.
What do you want? Burke called back.
Me and Al want to give up! Decker shouted.
Give up echoed several times.
That's up to the sheriff! Burke called back up.
Sheriff, tell them boys not to shoot! We're coming down!
Decker shouted.
Down, down, down! Echoed.
All right, toss your guns out, then come down with your hands up, the sheriff replied.
Simmons and Decker responded to the sheriff's order, then, with their hands up, climbed down from their perch behind the rocks. 2 weeks later, tried and convicted, they were delivered to the prison at Huntsville. Chapter 2 Slash Bell Ranch, Travis County, Texas. 6 mounted men materialized out of the darkness, riding slowly and quietly. Of the 6 men, only their leader, Dirk Kendrick, was not carrying a large wire-cutter tool. When they reached a long stretch of barbed wire, he held up his hand. More than 100 calves were on the other side of the wire. Most were sleeping, but many were moving around anxiously, searching for their mothers. For though they had been physically weaned away from the teat, they were not yet emotionally ready to be alone.
"Cut from here to there," Kendrick said, pointing to locations on the wire fence. "Cut all 5 strands."
When the wires were cut, 5 horsemen looped their ropes around the posts standing between the 2 cuts and urged their mounts on. The horses easily pulled the posts from the ground, then dragged the section of fence away, leaving a 20-foot opening. Aware that something had happened, even the calves that had been asleep were on their feet.
"All right, boys, let's get the creatures out of there,"
Kendrick ordered. All 6 men went into the pen, and within less than a minute, every calf had been moved out, each content to move as long as all the others were moving. Merrilltown, Texas. When Jason Bellefontaine, owner of the Slash Bell Ranch, left the theater, he decided to have a few drinks over at the CSS Alabama saloon before returning home. Owner Ken Prescott had been a crewman aboard the Confederate Raider and had honored his saloon with the name. He had lived in Mobile before the war and was signed on to the ship by Admiral Semmes, who at the time was also a resident of Mobile.
"Tell me, Ken, do the folks back in Mobile actually live in houses?"
Bellefontaine teased.
"Not just houses, my friend, but mansions," Prescott replied. "You will find some of the most beautiful mansions in all of America on Adams or St. Anthony, Claiborne or Conception Streets, right there in Mobile." "Then why did you leave if there are such beautiful homes in Mobile?"
Prescott smiled. "Because I didn't live on any of those streets. I lived on Telegraph Road." Bellefontaine laughed.
"Good enough reason. Besides, if you had stayed in Mobile, we wouldn't have the Alabama Saloon, and where would I go when I have a thirst for a beer?"
"You could always go to the Hog Pen," Prescott suggested, mentioning one of the other saloons in town. Whereas the CSS Alabama was a very pleasant saloon with a convivial atmosphere, the Hog Pen catered to a considerably more crude clientele.
I would be real welcome in the hog pen now, wouldn't I? Bellefontaine finished his drink, then set the glass down on the bar. Take care, my friend. I'll see you later. Bye, Jason, Prescott said, as Bellefontaine started toward the door. Bellefontaine rode through the dark to return home, thinking of the unbranded calves that had been rounded up over the last 2 days. Tomorrow his crew would be branding them, then turning them back into the herd. It promised to be a busy day, so reason told him he would be better served by returning to the ranch and going to bed. It took him no more than half an hour to cover the 5 miles between his ranch and Merrilltown, and though he had no watch, he was certain it had to be after 11 o'clock by the time he dismounted in front of the barn. He was about to unsaddle his horse when someone came toward him, moving out of the shadows. It was so dark he couldn't see who it was, and for a moment he thought the worst. Cautiously, he let his hand slip down to rest on his pistol. Recognizing Sam Post, his foreman, he relaxed.
"Hello, Sam. I thought sure you and the others would be in bed by now, especially given how hard you all worked today," Bellefontaine said as he returned to the job of unsaddling his horse.
"We've got a problem, boss."
"What kind of problem?"
"When I stepped out of the bunkhouse about an hour ago, I heard the calves we had cut out for Brandon today all bawling and such, so I rode out to check on them just to make sure they were all right."
"And?"
"They're gone, boss. Every damn one of them."
"Damn. How did they get away? Did the fence fall?"
"No, sir. The fence didn't fall. It was cut."
"Cut? You mean by the fence busters?"
"Oh, it was the fence busters, all right, Mr. Bellefontaine. Ain't no doubt in my mind about it."
"Dirk Kendrick?"
"Yes, sir. That's what I figure, all right. That's why I've got all the men up and dressed," Sam said.
"What for?"
"So we can go after him.
Don't forget, boss, those were some of the newly born Hereford calves. You don't want to lose any of them, do you?"
"Sam, suppose we did go after them.
What good would it do? Remember, we aren't dealing with your average rustler here. The fence busters are as well-organized a group of men as I have seen since Robert E. Lee surrendered my regiment to the Yankees at Appomattox. If we go after them with no more than a handful of cowboys, we are going to wind up getting a bunch of good men killed."
"Does that mean we don't do anything at all?"
"We can go see Sheriff Wallace," Bellefontaine suggested.
"Dirk Kendrick has Sheriff Wallace in his pocket. You know that. Deputy Bullock is so slimy, I don't see how even Wallace can put up with him."
"Yeah, well, I tend to agree with you," Bellefontaine said. "But right now, what other choice do we have?"
"You've got those Angus beeves coming in before too much longer," Sam said. "I'd hate to see some of them get stole like these was."
"We'll just have to be extra careful," Bellefontaine said.
"How many?" the ranch owner asked.
109, Kendrick replied. 85 are Herefords and 24 are Longhorns."
"It'll cost you $5 a head to keep them here, same for the Longhorns as for the Herefords."
"The Longhorns are worth only half as much as the Herefords," Kendrick complained.
"Whatever the cattle are worth on the market means nothing to me," the ranch owner replied. "I run the same risk in holding stolen Longhorns that I do stolen Herefords. The law makes no difference so far as stolen property is concerned."
"I didn't say I wasn't going to pay it. I need some place to keep them, and right now your ranch is the only place I have."
"Yeah, it is. Listen, I was thinking, maybe you had better cut some of my fence and run off a few head of Longhorn. I'll claim I had several head of Hereford stolen. I wouldn't want people getting suspicious because my fence wasn't cut and I wasn't losing cattle just like everyone else is."
Kendrick chuckled. "I see what you mean.
It is to our mutual benefit to maintain a degree of secrecy with regard to our business arrangement. All right. As soon as we get the cattle we acquired tonight remanded to an area that offers the least chance of discovery, we run off a few of your Longhorns."
"Just what is it you expect me to do?"
Sheriff Wallace asked when he was approached by Bellefontaine the next morning.
"Well, you are the sheriff, and I did have some of my cattle stolen. The correct thing to do when you have some of your property stolen is to report it to the sheriff."
"Yeah, well, first of all, how do you know your cows were stole?"
"What do you mean, how do I know? The calves were gathered in a pen to be branded. They were there, now they aren't there."
"And you say it was the fence busters?"
"It had to be. The fence was cut."
"Was the fence on public or private land?"
It was on public land. I run a lot of my cattle on public land and fence off my cattle to keep them separated from other brands. All the cattlemen do that. The only thing we do is make sure that everyone has equal access to the water.
Hell, you know that, Wallace.
Yes, I do know that, and therein lies the rub,
Sheriff Wallace said. What do you mean?
You know damn well, Bellefontaine, that there is no law against cutting fences that are on public land. If it was the fence busters, there's nothing I can do about it. They have every right to be cutting the fences. In fact, they have been hired by a legitimate company in New York to do that very thing.
Yes, but I don't think they have been hired to steal my cattle, Bellefontaine replied. No legitimate land company would do that, besides which I am not the only one having cattle stolen. I checked with some of the other ranchers before I rode in here this morning, and a few of them lost cattle last night, too.
You said it was calves, didn't you?
Yes. Then how do you know they were stolen? If it was calves, it's more than likely they just wandered off on their own looking for their mamas. That's what calves do, you know. It wasn't calves that were taken from Chris Doomy or Tom Bird or Donald Dobbins. It was cows, full grown and ready for market. Whether you are willing to admit it or not, the fence busters are nothing more than cattle thieves. They might try and pass themselves off as legitimate businessmen, but nobody in the entire state believes that.
I wouldn't be so quick to make that accusation if I were you, Sheriff Wallace replied. You may not realize it, but you are setting yourself up for a lawsuit. Big companies like the New York and Texas Land Company have lots of money, and they can afford very expensive lawyers. It wouldn't be good for them to be accused of association with cattle rustlers. I'd lay off if I was you.
Bellefontaine sighed. Sam told me I was wasting my time coming here. And he was right.
Even if what you say is true, how do you expect me to do anything about it? There are at least 40 fence busters. I've just got Deputy Bullock.
Disgusted, but not really surprised, Bellefontaine left the sheriff's office and rode back out to his ranch.
What did the sheriff tell you?
Sam asked when Bellefontaine returned. You're right, he isn't going to do anything.
We need to get rid of him come the next election, Sam said. He's worthless as tits on a steer.
I would suggest that you run for sheriff, except that you are too good a foreman and I wouldn't want to lose you. Sam grinned.
I'm not going anywhere, boss. I like riding for the brand.
Chapter 3 Blowout, Texas. The town was a scattering of fly-blown, crumbling adobe buildings, laid out on the east side of the Blanco River about 3 miles below the origin of Blanco Creek. The name came from Blowout Cave, located in a hillside east of the river about a mile above the spring. At one time, the cave had been home to thousands of bats, and over at least 100 years, a huge deposit of guano had accumulated. Ammonia and other gases from the decomposing guano had built up to such a degree in the cave that it was impossible for anyone to breathe, thus no one could even stand to be there long enough to mine it for fertilizer. During a thunderstorm, lightning struck at the cave mouth and ignited the gases. The resultant explosion carved away almost one-third of the mountain and gave the town its name. It had no city marshal nor a sheriff, and had trouble filling those positions since 3 law officers had been killed over the last 2 years. Those hapless victims of Blowout's lawlessness lay buried in a part of the cemetery known as the Lawman's Corner. Blowout wasn't an outlaw town as such. There were still decent citizens and merchants who were trapped in the town by circumstances. Occasionally they would hold secret meetings and plan ways to attract someone willing to put on a badge. At the moment, such a meeting was taking place.
"Who is going to give his life to be the sheriff in this town?"
asked Wes Long, owner of the mercantile.
"We didn't do anything to help any of the previous lawmen stand up to Kendrick, and we aren't likely to show any more courage for the next sheriff. Besides, we already got law."
Fred Matthews owned the wholesale and freight company.
"What are you talking about, Fred? You call Dirk Kendrick law?" "Yeah, I do. I mean, when you think about it, he keeps his men sober and won't let any of them run roughshod over the citizens of the town. He keeps the peace."
"It's a hell of a piece, is all I've got to say," Long added. As had all previous meetings, that one ended in frustration and failure. They had not been able to come up with one suggestion to deal with the problem at hand.
the occupation of the town by Dirk Kendrick and the Fencebusters. Wheatland, Wyoming. Wheatland was 25 miles north of Chugwater and more than twice as large. The greater population had brought Duff to town, for it was there that he was able to make arrangements to have enough cattle cars delivered to the railhead in Chugwater to accommodate the cattle he would be shipping. Once he had completed all the arrangements, he stopped at Nippy Jones' tavern to have a beer before he started home to Sky Meadow Ranch. Only one other customer was at the bar, standing at the opposite end. Duff got the distinct impression that the man was looking at him. More than looking, the man was studying him. Duff started to walk down and introduce himself, but before he could do so, the man left the saloon. He also left a beer mug that was more than three quarters full. As Duff was mulling this over, Nippy Jones, the owner of the saloon, came down to speak with him.
"Hello, Duff. What brings you to town?"
"Hello, Nippy. I came to town so that I might lease 20 stock cars."
Over the years, since he had arrived in the United States, Duff had done a considerable amount of business in Wheatland. As a result, he knew several of the local businessmen. As it so happened, Nippy Jones and Baldy Johnson, owner of Fiddler's Green, were also very good friends.
Shipping some stock to Kansas City, are you?"
"Nay, to Texas. I've sold some cattle to a rancher there."
"Ah, it's about time Texas started improving their ranches with good Wyoming cattle."
"Scottish cattle," Duff corrected.
"'Tis true that they'll be coming from Wyoming, but the breed is from Scotland."
Nippy laughed.
"I'll not argue with you. By the way, how is the old sergeant major doing?" Nippy asked.
"Baldy's doing quite well, and 'tis his own regards he asks that I bring you."
"And give him my best as well," Nippy replied.
"Nippy, the gent that just left your establishment, would you be knowing his name?"
Nippy shook his head. "I never laid eyes on him till he come here today."
Suddenly he brightened and held up his hand.
"But I think he must know you no more than 15 minutes before you came in. He asked about you."
"What did he ask?"
"He asked if you came here often. He said he was wanting to meet you, and that's funny now that you think about it. If he actually did want to meet you, I wonder why it is that he didn't stay and talk.
'Tis enough to make a man wonder now, isn't it?"
"Don't you find that a little peculiar?" Nippy asked.
"Aye, 'tis peculiar, all right. But I've lived long enough to have seen many a peculiar fellow. If you don't mind, I'll be for taking my drink over to the table."
"Go find your table, and I'll bring your drink myself," Nippy offered.
Shortly after Duff's drink was delivered to him, two men came into the saloon, talking with each other as they stepped in through the swinging batwing doors. Once they were inside, they separated. The big bearded man went to one end of the bar, while the smaller of the two, who had a handlebar mustache but no beard, went to the opposite end. Both of them appeared to take no notice of Duff, but he couldn't help but notice that both were studying him in the mirror. To most people, the fact that those two men had come in together, talking as if they were old friends, then taking up positions far apart from each other, would mean nothing. But for Duff, it activated a little signal of alarm. He had the feeling they were setting up an ambush, and he had an even stronger feeling that he was a target. Deliberately and as unobtrusively as he possibly could, Duff slid his pistol out of his holster, then held it on his lap under the table. He had never developed the skill of the fast draw, which seemed so prized by all Westerners, but did whatever needed to be done to give him an even chance any time he was forced into a confrontation. For that reason, he held the pistol on his lap. He had one additional advantage, one that required no manipulation of the situation in order for it to be effective. He was an exceptionally accurate shot, and his prowess extended with equal skill to the pistol and the long gun. Even as he wondered about the strange behavior of the two men who had just come in, the same man who'd left a few minutes earlier returned and walked right to the center of the bar. He was met by Nippy Jones.
"You left your beer more than half full last time you was here, mister. I can replace it if you like, but it'll cost you the price of a new beer."
"I'll do my drinking after," the man said.
"After?"
"After me and this fellow over here finish up with our business."
The man turned to face Duff. Here it is, Duff thought. He almost felt a sense of relief, not only because it was proof positive that his natural instincts were still active and correct in the assessment of danger, but also because the threat was imminent and he could deal with it right away.
"Would you be the Scotsman they called Duff MacCallister?" the man asked.
"Aye, Duff MacCallister, 'tis my name."
"Is that a fact? Well, Mr. Duff MacCallister, my name is Decus Pollard, and I'm calling you out now."
With that announcement, a sudden repositioning of all the other patrons in the saloon occurred as most everyone moved to get out of the line of fire should shooting begin. Duff noticed that neither of the two men who'd come in just before Pollard had moved. In fact, they seemed to be studying their beer, which seemed very strange given the possibility that they might be in the line of fire.
"Mr. Pollard, would you be for telling why you wish to pick this fight with me? What difference does it make? You'll be dead in another couple minutes, and once you're dead, how or why you was killed won't make no difference at all."
"Ah, so you are a philosopher, as well as a gunman. I have found that philosophers are some of the most interesting men I have ever encountered. 'Tis a shame I'm going to have to kill you."
Pollard's smile disclosed crooked yellow teeth.
"I ain't the one that's going to be killed, you see. I got me what you might call an edge."
"An edge, you say? Do you think that's fair?"
"Fair? What do you mean fair, you damn fool? I'm here to kill you. Fair ain't got nothing to do with it."
"But in that case, I shall feel no compunction about acquiring my own edge, and you'll have no cause for complaint, seeing as you have already established the parameters for our tete-a-tete."
"For what?"
"You're right.
Tete-a-tete would ne be the correct word, would it? I mean, of course, because a tete-a-tete normally refers to a head-to-head encounter between two people, and 'tis obvious that isn't to be the case here."
"I don't know what you're talking about, but I can tell you right now you won't be a-drinking no tea."
Duff chuckled, though instead of humor, there was a raw, almost dangerous edge to his laughter.
"This is a life-or-death situation. Wouldn't you agree?"
"Yes."
"And in a life-or-death situation, one should take every advantage, should they not?"
Duff cocked the pistol he was holding under the table.
"Yeah,"
Pollard said.
"I'm glad to hear you say that. Oh, and you two gents standing on either end of the bar, I suspect that you are a part of this. If you are, you will die along with Mr. Pollard. If you aren't, then you need to leave now while you can."
"Draw!" Pollard shouted.
Duff didn't squeeze the trigger until Pollard had his gun in hand. Pollard's victorious smile changed to an expression of shock when he heard the roar of a gunshot and felt the bullet tear into his stomach. He dropped his own unfired pistol and slapped his hands over the bleeding wound in his stomach.
"What the hell? Where'd that gun come from?"
shouted the big bearded man standing at the bar. He put his hands up, as did the smaller man standing at the opposite end of the bar.
"Don't shoot! Don't shoot!"
the bearded man shouted. "We ain't in on this!" Duff pulled the still-smoking pistol out from under the table.
"Would the two of you be good enough to take your guns out of your holsters and lay them on the bar?"
"Why, I told you we ain't going to do nothing."
Duff cocked his pistol, the sound of the hammer drawing back, making a loud metallic click in what had become a very silent room.
"I'll ne be asking again."
All right, I'm a-doing it," the bearded man said.
As he slowly drew his pistol to put it on the bar, the other man followed suit. Duff nodded to the owner.
"Mr. Jones, if you would be so good as to remove the bullets from the two guns, I would appreciate it."
Nippy Jones did so.
"Now, if you two gentlemen would be joining me, I would like to buy you a drink."
"You want to buy us a drink?"
"Aye."
"Why?"
"Have you ever heard the expression, keep your friends close, but keep your enemies closer?"
"Nah, I ain't never heard nothing like that,"
the bearded man said as he and his companion joined Duff at his table.
"Well, 'tis an old Chinese proverb. To that end, would you be for telling me your names?"
"I'm Tremble,"
the larger of the two men said.
"He's Harrison."
"Mr. Tremble, Mr. Harrison, why did you want to kill me?"
The two men looked at each other for a second, then Harrison spoke.
"We didn't want to kill you. There ain't neither one of us ever even heard of you before today.
It was Pollard that wanted to kill you. He seen you when you was down at the depot, and he said he'd give us $20 apiece if we'd come along with him.
Oh, that's most disheartening to think that my life would be worth no more than $40.
Yeah, well, here's the thing, Chambo said. We wasn't supposed to have to do anything but just be standing there and sort of back him up. Pollard said he'd be able to kill you all by his own self.
And why is that? Why did he want to kill me, I mean?
He said you killed his brother.
Duff shook his head.
He was mistaken.
I've never killed anyone named Pollard.
The sheriff and his deputy had arrived, and after interviewing several eyewitnesses, informed Duff that the killing of Pollard was justifiable homicide and that he needn't be present for the official inquiry.
What about these two? Duff asked, indicating Tremble and Harrison. Can we charge them with attempted murder?
I'm not sure that we can, the sheriff replied. As I understand it, neither of them actually even drew their guns.
I think it would be hard to make a case against them.
That's right, Sheriff, we just happened to be standing there when it all happened.
Uh-huh, the sheriff replied, showing his disbelief. I'll say this for you, you are a couple of very lucky men.
You mean, cause you can't charge us with nothing?
Chamberlain asked.
No, I mean you are lucky that you didn't actually take part in the shooting.
I know you didn't, because if you had been a part of it, you would both be dead now.
What makes you think that? Chamberlain charged. I mean, don't get me wrong, we wasn't a part of it, but if we had been, there would have been three of us to his one. More than likely, MacCallister would be the one that would be dead now.
The sheriff chuckled cynically.
Of course he would be, he said sarcastically.
Now I want you two to get out of my town before I change my mind.
You got no right to run us out of town, Harrison said.
I don't have to run you out of town. I can put you in jail.
How are you going to put us in jail? We ain't neither one of us done nothing. You ain't got no reason.
I'll keep you in jail till I think of a reason, the sheriff replied. No need for that, Tremble said. We're leaving.
Hey, Tremble, Harrison said, as the two men rode out of town. Well, I don't mean you wait here, and when MacCallister rides by, we'll shoot him.
What would be the advantage of that? Tremble replied. Pollard's dead. We wouldn't make any money from it.
Yeah, well, maybe not. But we could get some satisfaction out of it.
How about getting satisfaction and a lot of money? Tremble suggested.
What do you mean? Do you have an idea?
Yeah.
Chapter 4 Blowout. Carl Peabody pushed through the swinging batwing doors of the Four Kings Saloon.
We cut fence where Jim Crockett was pinning in some of his cows, and we got 50 Herefords, he said as he approached the table near the back of the room where Dirk Kendrick was sitting.
Kendrick was playing solitaire. He held a card, studying the board for a play.
Any trouble?
No trouble. We took him to the Double D, and he said you'll owe him $250 for parking the cattle there.
It's worth it, Kendrick said as he turned up the Queen of Hearts.
Ah, good. I've been looking for that one.
Are you sure it's worth it? Seems to me like we're paying an awful lot of money just to park our cattle there. I mean, at $5 a head, for as many as we've got there, it's beginning to add up.
Tell me, Peabody, do you think we could buy cattle for $5 a head?
What? No, you know we couldn't do that.
And look at it as if we're acquiring a rather sizable herd at an exceptional bargain. In addition, we have a place for them to graze, as well as a place to hide them out. The Double D is one of the most respected ranches in the whole area. Nobody's ever going to think to look for stolen cattle there.
Yeah, Peabody said. Yeah, I reckon I can see that.
Now go away and let me finish this game, Kendrick said. Tell Weasel to give you a drink on me.
Thanks.
Peabody headed toward the bar. Northern Colorado. The snow-capped peaks of the Rocky Mountains were white against the night sky. Four men waited in the darkness, gathered in a shallow depression behind a water tower. Before them, twin rails gleamed in the moonlight.
It'll be easier than eating a piece of apple pie. All we got to do is wait for the train to stop for water, then we'll take it over.
You know the cattle will be on this train? Abner Grant asked.
Yeah, when I was in Wheatland, I seen him get 20 cars. 20 cars with 25 head on each one of 'em is 500 head. And once we take the train, the cows will belong to us.
I hope you're right. If you are, this'll sure be easier in rustling them, Mo Sutton said.
Tremble's right. I was in Wheatland, too. Me and him both seen MacCallister ordering the cars, Harrison said.
They heard a distant whistle.
There it is, boys, Tremble said with a wide smile. We're about to be rich.
Cephas Prouty, the engineer, was leaning out of the cab, looking ahead at the long beam of light cast by the mirrored headlamp just forward of the smokestack. He held his eyes squinted against the 18-mile-per-hour wind being generated by the speed of the train. Behind him was the tender, 20 stock cars filled with cattle, a car that was carrying 3 horses, a private passenger car, and a caboose.
I was getting nervous during this part of the run, the fireman said. They got this water tank just about as far from the last one as you can possibly go before the tank runs plumb dry, and if that happens, we sure as hell can't get out and push.
Cephas laughed.
You worry too much, Doodle. It's only a couple more miles.
He checked the gauge.
Pressure is holding up pretty good. We could damn nigh coast from here on in.
Doodle laughed.
Yeah, well, every time we get to this part of the road, I get to thinking we may need to. And one of these days, if the tank ain't that good and full from the last time we took on water, we damn near may have to coast.
Back in the private car, each in their own bedroom compartment, Duff, Elmer, and Wang were sound asleep. When the train began slowing, the change in the motion awakened Duff, and he sat up to have a look out his window. They were coming to a stop, and at first he wondered why, then he realized they must be approaching a water tank. He lay there for a few minutes, then decided to take advantage of the stop to check on Skye and the other horses. Pulling on his boots, he hopped down, then walked up to the car that was just forward of the private car. Looking ahead, he saw that the spout had been brought down from the tank. The fireman was standing on top of the tender, taking on water. Satisfied that nothing was amiss, Duff peered in through the slats on the side of the car and saw the 3 horses standing calmly, no doubt asleep. He was about to return to his car when he heard someone speaking.
That's it, Mr. Fireman. You just keep on pumping in that water till you got the tank good and full, someone said. We'll be a-needin' that.
Startled not only by the voice, but by the fact the voice was familiar, Duff looked toward the front of the train, where he saw 4 men silhouetted against the glare of the headlamp. With drawn pistols, they were advancing toward the engine. Train robbers? But what would they be robbing? The train is neither express car nor passenger, so what do they want? As soon as he thought the question, the answer came to him. They weren't robbing the train. They intended to steal the train and the cattle. Duff hurried back to the private car.
Elmer! Wang! Wake up! What is it?
Elmer asked, sticking his head through the door to his room.
The train is being robbed.
Robbed? What do you mean, robbed? What are they stealing?
They're stealing the whole train, Duff said.
Even as he was talking, Duff was strapping on his pistol. It took but a moment for Elmer and Wang to join him. The train was still stopped, still in the process of taking on water when the 3 men left the car.
How do we want to do this? Elmer asked. I'll advance up the right-hand side of the train, Elmer. You go up the left side.
I will go on top, Wang said.
I was hoping you might suggest that. Wang, if this train gets started before me and Duff get up there, it's up to you to get it stopped. Elsewise, we're likely to get stranded, and it'll be a mighty long walk into the next town.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.